be speaking about the regulation of breathing. Breathing, it is actually the intake of oxygen and removal of carbon dioxide is called as breathing. A normal healthy adult, he breathes about 12 to 16 times per minute, and this breathing it lasts for 5 seconds. So breathing it lasts for 5 seconds. Breathing is nothing but the inspiration as well as expiration. Intake of oxygen is called inspiration and removal of carbon dioxide is called expiration. And inspiration it lasts for 2 seconds and expiration it actually lasts for 3 seconds. So a healthy normal adult, he will be breathing about 12 to 16 times per minute. And infants, the breathing rate is much higher when compared to the adults. That is, the infants will be breathing about 44 times per minute. How many times? 44 times per minute. And breathing, it is an involuntary process. So it is an involuntary process. We cannot control our breathing according to our needs. But still, the rhythm of the breathing, it can be changed according to our body needs. So the rhythm of the breathing, it can be changed. In our human beings, we have the capacity to change the rhythm of the breathing according to the body needs. And here, that is called as the regulation of breathing. And it is called as the regulation of breathing. And this regulation of breathing can be brought about by, it can be, the regulation of breathing can be done by the nervous system. So if the breathing is regulated by nervous system, it is called as nervous regulation or neural regulation. Neural regulation. If the breathing is controlled or regulated by the release of chemicals, then that is called as chemical regulation. We shall speak about that later. First, let us speak about the nervous regulation or the neural regulation. So, what is nervous regulation or neural regulation? If the regulation of breathing, it is occurring by the nervous system, if the breathing rhythm is controlled by the respiratory, I mean nervous system, then it is called as the neural regulation. And for neural regulation to take place, inside our brain there are certain respiratory centers. So what are present in our brain? There are certain respiratory centers present on our brain, especially on pons, veroli and medulla oblongata. So one respiratory center is present on pons and two respiratory centers are present on medulla. Okay, and then these respiratory centers includes inspiratory center, and this inspiratory center is also called as dorsal respiratory groups. So this inspiratory center, this is the inspiratory center, which is also called as dorsal respiratory group. And the other center is expiratory center, and here this is the expiratory center. It is present adjacent to the inspiratory center. Where are these inspiratory and expiratory centers present? Both are present on the medulla oblongata. Okay, so this expiratory center, it is also called as ventral respiratory group. It is also called as ventral respiratory group. Okay, and there is one more center present here, that is called as pneumotoxic center. It is called as the pneumotoxic center. Okay, these three are the respiratory centers which are present on pons veroli as well as medulla oblongata. So here all these three centers, respiratory centers, which one? This pneumotoxic center, I'll be abbreviating it as PTC. This pneumotoxic center, inspiratory center, expiratory center, these three are the respiratory centers, and these three are together called as rhythm centers. They are called as rhythm center, and this rhythm center, it is involved in the controlling of the rhythm of breathing. So rhythm of breathing, it is controlled by this rhythm center. So rhythm center, it constitutes about there is inspiratory center, expiratory center and pneumotoxic center. So inspiratory center, what do you mean by inspiratory center? Inspiratory center, it is active during normal inspiration. So it brings about the normal inspiration. It is active during normal inspiration. That means, what does the center do? So during normal inspiration, you all know that the normal inspiration is an active process, whereas normal expiration is a passive process. During normal inhalation, what happens? The contraction of the intercostal muscles and diaphragm takes place. As a result, inspiration takes place. So during normal inspiration, this inspiratory center, it sends signal to both intercostal muscles and diaphragm to contract. So here during normal inspiration, what happens? This is the diaphragm, and here are the, assume this as the intercostal muscles. So during normal inspiration, what happens? These intercostal muscles and this diaphragm, they are getting signal from the inspiratory center for the contraction. So as soon as they receive the signals for contraction, this diaphragm, the muscles of the diaphragm, it will be contracted, so that this muscular dome shaped diaphragm, it gets flattened. And when these intercostal muscles receive the signals from intercostal muscles for contraction, these intercostal muscles contract. So when the contraction takes place, the ribs are pushed outwards. So what happens? Now the ribs will be pushed towards outwards. As a result, inspiration takes place. So this is how inspiration occurs, and the signals are sent by inspiratory center for the contraction for inspiration. And now let us move on to the expiratory center. Expiratory center, it is dormant during normal inspiration or normal breathing. So it is usually dormant. It is dormant during normal breathing. It is dormant or it is inactive during normal breathing. But this expiratory center, it gets stimulated during exercise. So when we are doing exercise, at that time what happens? This expiratory center, it gets activated. So when it gets activated, this expiratory center, when it gets activated during physical exercises, so during physical activities, this expiratory center, now it sends signals to the same intercostal muscles and diaphragm. I told you, the forceful expiration is actually the active process. So here, when this expiratory center, it gets activated during exercise, it results in forceful expiration. So it results in forceful expiration. It results in forceful expiration. So when this expiratory center gets activated during the physical activities, now this expiratory center, it sends signal to the intercostal muscles and diaphragm. So during forceful expiration, what happens? Now these intercostal muscles, they are contracted. So they will be contracting towards inwards. As a result, what happens during forceful inspiration? Now the ribs, they will be pulled towards inwards. So now they are pulled towards inwards. And this diaphragm muscles, they are also directed for the contraction. So now what happens during forceful inspiration, the muscular dome shaped diaphragm, it further becomes even more dome shaped. As a result, the volume inside the thoracic cavity decreases and thus forceful expiration takes place. So this is how the expiratory center, it gets stimulated only during physical exercises, and it results in forceful expiration. And then this pneumotoxic center, where it is present, in the pons veri, whereas inspiratory center and expiratory center both are present on medulla, and pneumotoxic center, which is the center, this is pneumotoxic center, it is nothing but the pneumotoxic center. So it is present on the pons, and even this pneumotoxic center, it also stimulates during exercise, so this center, so called pneumotoxic center, it also gets stimulated during physical exercise. So when we are running fast, the rhythm of our breathing, it changes. So when we are running faster and faster, the breath we are taking, it becomes, the breathing rate, it becomes more, but it will be shallower. So when this pneumotoxic center, it gets stimulated during exercise, so here breathing rate, what happens, breathing rate increases, but breathing will be shallower. So we will be breathing at a faster pace, but the breath what we are intaking and exhaling air, so that breathing, it will be shallower, just like panting in case of dogs. Dogs, they will be panting by keeping their tongue outside. So in such cases, that is called as panting. So that is how we pant when we have run fast. Okay, so inspiratory center, expiratory center, pneumotoxic center, together it is called as the rhythm center. So this rhythm center, it actually sends signal to the respiratory muscles through the neurons, so that it will be making the necessary adjustments, whether we have to inhale or exhale. So that will be controlled by this rhythm center. And there is one more regulation of breathing involved, that is called as chemical regulation. So the chemical regulation. We shall speak about it. Now, what is this chemical regulation? The rhythm of breathing changes when it is stimulated by the release of certain chemicals like carbon dioxide and protons, or it is also called as hydrogen ions. So when there is a release of these elements like carbon dioxide and protons inside our body, the chemical chemoreceptor, it gets activated. But what do you mean by this chemical chemoreceptor? This chemical chemoreceptor, it is also a respiratory center which is present adjacent to the rhythm center. So here, this chemical chemoreceptor center, it is present adjacent to the rhythm center. And whenever there is an increase in carbon dioxide or protons, this center, it is highly sensitive to the increased elements of carbon dioxide and protons. So whenever these elements, they increases inside our body, this center, it gets stimulated. So this center, it gets stimulated due to the production of more carbon dioxide and protons. So this center, it gets activated. When this chemical chemocenter receptor activates, now this in turn activates the rhythm center. When there is an increase in carbon dioxide and protons, this chemical center, it gets activated, and again in turn this chemical center, it will activate the rhythmicity center. So when this center is activated, now this center, it will make the necessary adjustments to throw these elements outside of the body. So like this, the chemical regulation takes place. And one more thing, there are carotid bodies and aortic bodies present here. And these carotid bodies and aortic bodies, they are also sensitive to the increase in carbon dioxide and protons. So whenever there is the increase in carbon dioxide and protons inside our body, even these carotid bodies and aortic bodies, they also get stimulated, they also get activated. In such case, what happens? These two, carotid bodies and aortic bodies, when they are stimulated, again they will send signals to the rhythmic center to make the necessary adjustments to throw them out. Which one? To remove the carbon dioxide and protons from the body to put them outside. So this is how the chemical regulation takes place inside our body, And one more thing is, beside this pneumotoxic center, here there is one more apneustic center. So there is one more apneustic center. Whenever there is a, whenever there is a damage occurring to the pneumotoxic center, it sends signal to the apneustic center, and this apneustic center, it causes prolonged breathing. At some time, what happens when we are sleeping, we will take deep breath. So there what happens, the breathing stops and again it starts. So at that time what happens, we will be taking in more oxygen. So prolonged inspiration, and that prolonged inspiration is called as apnea. Okay, so this is about the regulation of breathing. The control of breathing, or the breathing is regulated by nervous system as well as by the release of certain chemicals. So that is called as neural regulation and chemical regulation. And in neural regulation, there are three centers, namely inspiratory center, expiratory center and pneumotoxic center. So inspiratory center, it gets activated during normal breathing, and it brings about normal inspiration. And expiratory center, it gets activated only during physical exercise, when we are doing physical exercise, and it brings about forceful expiration. Whereas pneumotoxic center, it also gets stimulated during exercise. And chemical regulation, in chemical regulation, what happens when there is an increase in the carbon dioxide and protons? These chemicals, they stimulate the chemoreceptors which are present adjacent to the rhythm center. And when it is stimulated, this chemoreceptor, it in turn again activates the rhythmicity center to make the necessary adjustment to remove these elements, outside of the body. And then again, here carotid bodies and aortic bodies which are present here, they are also sensitive to the release of these carbon dioxide and protons inside our body. Again, when there is an increase in these elements also stimulates the carotid bodies and aortic bodies. And when they are stimulated, these bodies, again they will send signal to the rhythm centers to make the necessary adjustments, to throw these elements outside of the body. Now let us go through certain MCQs. What is correct about human respiration? Option A. About 90% of carbon dioxide is carried by hemoglobin as carbaminohemoglobin. B. Neural signals from pneumotoxic center of pons can increase the duration of inspiration. B. Workers in grinding and stone breaking industries may suffer from lung fibrosis. C. Cigarette smoking leads to inflammation of bronchi. So, which is the right option? Option C. Why? Because about 90% of carbon dioxide is carried by hemoglobin as carbaminohemoglobin. No. So, in the form of carbaminohemoglobin, only 20 to 25% of carbon dioxide is transported. Neural signals from pneumotoxic center of pulse can increase the duration of inspiration. So it will not increase the duration of inspiration. It gets activated during exercise. So here the breathing rate, it will increase, but shallow breathing it can be seen. And then option C, workers in grinding and stone breaking industries may suffer from lung fibrosis. So lung fibrosis is nothing but the damaged condition. So lungs, the layer of the lungs, it will be damaged. So there small pores will be there, it will be damaged, and there due to the deposition of certain fibrous tissues, what happens, the lung tissues, it will be thick, it will be thick. So that is the right option. It can be seen in case of the people who are working at grinding and stone breaking. We will be discussing about this later on. That is the right option. And D, smoking leads to, cigarette smoking leads to inflammation of bronchi. We will be speaking about that. So option C. Choose the right sequential phenomenon during the passage of carbon dioxide from blood to tissues. Option A, absorption of carbon dioxide by blood. Sorry, that is statement P, absorption of carbon dioxide by blood. Q, reaction of carbon dioxide with water forming H2CO3 inside RBCs and then HCO3 minus and H plus ions. R, reaction of carbon dioxide with water forming H2CO3 inside plasma followed by conversion into H plus and HCO3 minus ions. Yes, combination of H plus with heat part of HBO2 to release oxygen. T, combination of HCO3 with heat part of HBO2 to form reduced hemoglobin and release of oxygen. So which is the sequential phenomena during the passage of carbon dioxide from blood to tissues? So first is the absorption of carbon dioxide by blood, that is right. And then reaction of carbon dioxide with water forming H2CO3 carbonic acid inside RBCs and then bicarbonates and H plus ions that takes place. And then reaction of carbon dioxide with water forming H2CO3 inside plasma. So that will not take place inside plasma, instead it takes place inside the RBCs. And combination of these protons with heme part of oxyhemoglobin, that is HBO2, to release oxygen, of course it takes place. So which is the right option? That is, correct sequential order is P, Q and S. Which is the right option? Option C, P, Q, S. The transport of carbon dioxide by the blood is primarily dependent on the option A, solubility of carbon dioxide in blood, B, presence of carbonic anhydrase in RBCs, C, ability of hemoglobin to bind and transport carbon dioxide, D, ability of other blood proteins. So transport of carbon dioxide by blood is primarily dependent on, it actually depends upon the catalyst enzyme, that is presence of carbonic anhydrase in RBCs, option B. Pick the correct statement. Contraction of intercostal muscles lifts up the ribs and sternum. B, RBCs transport oxygen only. C, thoracic cavity is anatomically an airtight chamber. D, healthy man can inspire approximately 500 ml of air per minute. And E, during expiration, the interpleural pressure is slightly below the surrounding atmosphere pressure. So which is the right option? Which is the correct statement? Thoracic cavity is anatomically an airtight chamber. Why that is the right option? Because contraction of intercostal muscles lifts up the ribs and sternum. They have given internal intercostal muscles, but the contraction of external intercostal muscles lifts up the ribs and sternum. RBCs transport oxygen only, is that right? They can also carry carbon monoxide or carbon dioxide. And C, thoracic cavities are anatomically an airtight chamber, of course. Healthy men can inspire approximately about 500 ml of air per minute. So 500, it is the tidal volume we can inhale at one time. If we are inhaling, we will be inhaling 500 ml of air, and when we are exhaling, about 500 we will be exhaling. but per minute we will be exhaling or inhaling up to 6000 to 8000 ml of air. And thus that is also wrong. During expiration, the interpleural pressure is slightly below the surrounding atmospheric pressure. No, it is opposite to that. So option C. Next question. Respiratory rhythm center is present in which part of brain? So respiratory rhythm center, where it is present on option A, pons, B, medulla oblongata, C, cerebrum, D, cerebellum. It is present on medulla oblongata. So because inspiratory and expiratory centers are present on medulla oblongata, and thus option B. Pneumotoxic center is present in option A, pons, B, medulla oblongata, C, cerebrum, D, cerebellum. So pneumotoxic center, it is present on pons, option A. Human beings have a significant ability to maintain and moderate the respiratory rhythm to suit the demands of the body tissues. This is done by option A, endocrine system, B, neural system, C, excretory system, D, all of this. So it is done by neural system, option C, B, neural system. Next question, dash sensitive area is situated. It is situated adjacent to the rhythm center. Dash center, sensitive center, is situated adjacent to the rhythm center, which is highly sensitive to dash and dash ions. So here, which sensitive area is present adjacent to this rhythm center? It is chemosensitive area. It is chemosensitive area. Either you can pick it as chemosensitive area or chemical chemoreceptors, we can say it. Okay, and chemosensitive area is situated adjacent to rhythm center, which is highly sensitive to carbon dioxide and protons, hydrogen ions, option D. All of the following factors play an important role in the regulation of respiratory rhythm except option A, carbon dioxide, B, H+ concentration, C, oxygen, none of this. See, all the factors play an important role in regulation of rhythm of breathing except oxygen. So oxygen, it does not has any role in that. So the role of oxygen in rhythmicity of breathing, it is quite insignificant. So option C. Select the incorrect statement from the following. A, neural signal from pneumotoxic center can reduce the duration of inspiration. B, the role of oxygen in the regulation of respiratory rhythm is quite significant. C, RBCs contain a very high concentration of the enzyme carbonic anhydrase and minute quantities of the same is present in the plasma too. And carbon dioxide is carried by hemoglobin as carbaminohemoglobin about 20 to 25%. So which is incorrect statement? It is B. Why? Here they have given as the role of oxygen in the regulation of respiratory rhythm is quite significant, but it is quite insignificant. So option B. Respirators associated with aortic and carotid artery can recognize changes in dash and dash concentration and send necessary signal to dash for remedial action. So the receptors associated with aortic and carotid artery, so these are nothing but the aortic and receptors associated with aortic and carotid artery can recognize changes in dash and dash concentration. So that is carbon dioxide and protons concentration, and they send the necessary signal to dash for remedial action. So they will send signal to rhythm center for remedial action. So option B. Carbonic anhydrase is found in high concentration in option A, leukocytes, B, blood plasma, C, erythrocytes, D, lymphocytes. So it is higher in RBCs, so called erythrocytes, option C. The controlling center of normal breathing in mammals lies in option A, cerebrum, B, cerebellum, C, midbrain, D, medulla oblongata. So the controlling center of normal breathing in mammals normal breathing in mammals in the sense which center is controlling the normal breathing. It is inspiratory center, option D. That is located in medulla oblongata, option D. Number of RBCs per unit volume of blood is likely to be higher in a person living at higher altitudes because. So the number of RBCs per unit volume of blood is higher. Now the number of RBCs will be higher in a person who lives in higher altitude. Why? Because option A, air is clean and unpolluted. B, more sunshine is available. C, air is less dense. D, vegetation gives out more oxygen. So there, air is less dense, the availability of oxygen is also less, and thus in such persons, the number of RBCs increases. So option C.